Equipment services and over. It's just as usual, or this is. Well, one of the other things we have to, the doctor, he says, his parents.
Oh, my God, my God.
Two granddaughters.
Sure, yeah.
Their husbands. Three. I'm slightly out of it. He says they come to your place and consider, is that why you're so late? Well, see, that's the thing, you can hear you, so I'm not sure. I think I read this.
I Christ the King Sunday. Today, Steve for Crockett and Council follow worship. Thanksgiving Eve worship will be held here on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. A time of fellowship will follow the service. Church offices will be closed for Thanksgiving holiday both Thursday and Friday. Hanging of the greens will be Saturday, November 30th at 9 a.m. Rehearsal for the Children's Family Christmas Program will follow worship next Sunday. Our December Mission of Hope meal is scheduled for next Monday, December 2nd. Wednesday evening, Advent worship will be held December 4th and 11th at 7 p.m. Other announcements.
As you heard, their hanging of the wreath will be Saturday at 9 o'clock. Today, if any gentlemen or women would like to go to the shed, you could bring the crush in, we could put it in the hall, and since it's nice out today, we could get a start for not having to go get it out on Saturday.
And then I would add for, oh, I'm sorry. I would add for the Advent worship services December 4th and 11th. We are planning to have soup supper like we've had in the past. So if you would like to bring some soup or salad or bread or desserts, there'll be another sign up. There are multiple sign up sheets, but we'll get that up soon as well. In your bulletin, you will need the ELW Red Hymnal. This week we add prayers for Mickey Cox Barber Bridge, who is recovering from surgery to repair damage. And we continue our prayers for all in need and our prayers of intercession and community prayers. While some are healing or grieving, others have reason to celebrate. This week includes Evelyn's birthday and Randy and Mark's anniversary. With that, let us begin our prayer. We continue with our order of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, our refuge, our delight, our beginning, and our end.
Amen.
Let us come in truth before the one who loves us and has freed us from our sin. Eternal One, robed in majesty and mercy, we confess that sin has taken hold of us, and we are complicit in its power. We are disturbed in spirit, and our hearts cannot rest. Unbind us and set us free. Lead us again to the waters of rebirth, that we may live just and generous lives for the good of your world and the care of our neighbors, following in the servant way of Jesus. Amen. These words are trustworthy and true. Christ bore our sins once for all on the cross, swallowing up death forever. For his sake, you are forgiven. And God reminds me. remembers your sin no more, let your heart be glad again and rejoice in your salvation. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're comfortable for our opening hymn. Crown Him with Many Crowns, and we're singing all the verses.
Thank you. You anointed your beloved Son to be priest and sovereign forever. Grant that all the people of the earth, now divided by the power of sin, may be united by the glorious and gentle rule of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is from the 7th chapter of Daniel, verses 9 through 10 and 13 through 14. As I watched, thrones were set in place, and an ancient one took his throne. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, and its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and flowed out from his presence. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood attending him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were open. As I watched in the night vision, I saw one like a human being coming with the clouds of heaven. And he came to the ancient one and was presented before him. To him was given dominion and glory and kingship, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not pass away, and his kingship is one that shall never be destroyed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 93 will be spoken alternately. The Lord is King, robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and armed with strength. The Lord has made the world so sure that it cannot be moved.
Ever since the world began, your throne has been established. You are from everlasting.
The waters have lifted up, O Lord. The waters have lifted up their voice. The waters have lifted up their pounding waves.
Mightier than the sound of many waters, mightier than the ridges of the sea, mightier is the Lord who dwells on high.
Your testimonies are very sure, and holiness befits your house, O Lord, forever and forevermore. The second reading is from the first chapter of Revelation, verses 4-8. Praise to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he's coming with the clouds, every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and on his account all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Look out this way, will ya? I'm wondering, do you see any kings or queens out there? Do ya? No? How would you know they're a king or a queen? Because they would have to have crowns. How else would they be dressed? With horses, did you say? No? They might have a carriage, yeah, okay, or a limousine, okay. But would they have long dresses, maybe, or robes? Okay, would they have a cape, maybe? You think so? Well, I wonder, do we have any kings and queens out there? Any past kings and queens? Anybody, king or queen of homecoming? No? Prom? Yeah? Wait, go jam. Okay? How about Winterfest? I don't know about, you know, the Winterfest is maybe a relatively new thing, but I remember when I was in school. Any fair queens? No? Well, you know what we do have kings and queens today, but not like we hear about in the Disney movies. Have you ever heard about kings and queens in the Disney movies? Yeah? Like King Triton of Little Mermaid? Do you want to see what I brought my bag? If you said, I'll show you that I brought my bag. And you might even be able to hold it. Yeah? You want to? Okay. So you talked about crowns, right? A king or a queen wears a crown. But this one, it's kind of little. Let's see. Well, fit? Kind of. Isn't it pretty? It's sparkly. Is it made of gold? And it has diamonds on it? And pearls on it? Well, not really, but, you know. Well, just pretend, right? So, is this the kind of crown you like to wear if you were a king or a prince?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, well, you hold that one while I go get another one. I'm wondering if you might want to wear this one. Ouch. Ouch! I'm not pretending, people. I didn't know how I was going to pick it up. Look at this one. Is this a crown that you would want to wear?
No.
It's not a crown that I would want to wear either. It really did poke me. So who wore this kind of a crown? Jesus did, right? And we heard about his time before Pilate in our gospel reading today, but it's before they put this crown on his head and they called him the King of the Jews. Now, is this a crown fit for a king? No. But he wore it because he loves you and me and everyone so very much that he was willing to wear this on our behalf. So, on Palm Sunday, do you know about Palm Sunday? That's the Sunday before Easter. We sometimes have a parade into worship with palm branches. I wonder if we could have a parade today. Kings and queens have parades usually, right? Do you want to have a parade with me? Okay, we'll go down the center aisle and we're going to come back. You can hold the crown. Or if you want to wear it, that's okay too. King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, hallelujah. King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, hallelujah. Jesus. Thanksgiving is Thursday, as if we don't know that, right? Just a reminder. Advent, the time of waiting, watching, and preparing for Christmas begins next Sunday. So what's with today's gospel reading? I think it jolts us out of our pre-Thanksgiving visions we're having of turkey, stuffing, gravy, mashed potatoes, sweet potato, or green bean casserole, cranberry sauce, and oh, don't forget to leave room for the pie. We expect to hear this gospel reading in the darkness and the somberness of Good Friday. Winter is just beginning to show up outside, and we are nowhere near spring or Lent or Holy Week. What then are we doing here today in Pilate's headquarters? It's not a comfortable place to be. Power struggles breed conflict. As we picture the scene unfolding, what do we see? Who is in the room? Is it just Pilate and Jesus? Did the soldiers toss Jesus into Pilate's headquarters as if throwing him into a jail cell? Did Jesus lose his balance and fall? Did the soldiers slam the door shut? Did they stand guard inside or outside? Already, Jesus has been tossed to and fro, back and forth from one person to another before he landed in Pilate's headquarters. We know that by now Jesus' hands were bound. Was he bleeding? Did he have a fat lip or a black eye after being struck on the face when he was brought before Annas? Was Pilate's headquarters set up like a courtroom? Was Pilate standing over Jesus? Was Pilate sitting in a high-backed chair like a throne room, or maybe behind a judge's desk, up on the steps with Jesus at the foot of the steps? Was Jesus standing? Did they make eye contact? Is this any way to treat a king? Today is Christ the King Sunday. But what's Christ the King Sunday about? Is it yet another ancient church celebration centuries old? Is it of little significance in today, this day and age? I don't think so. Maybe, just maybe, we need Christ the King Sunday as much as when it began. Pope Pius XI introduced it in the aftermath of World War I amid growing nationalism. He sought to remind Christians that Christ reigns over our lives. Christ rules in our hearts. Its purpose was to point to the King, of whose kingdom there will be no end. The title of King for Jesus appears for the most part at the beginning and at the end of Jesus' earthly life. The Magi, you'll remember, other kings from afar, asked another king, King Herod, where is the child who has been born king of the Jews? Pilate, a ruler of Judea, asked Jesus on the day when he sentenced Jesus to death, are you the king of the Jews? In between his birth and his death, Jesus did not refer to himself as the King of the Jews. Instead, he preferred the title Son of Man. Why? Because Jesus did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. However, King of the Jews was an appropriate title for Jesus, as he was descended from the throne of King David. Now you may have noticed that Jesus didn't answer Pilate's question directly. Jesus could have simply said, I am. After all, we are in John's Gospel, where we find many of Jesus' I am statements. But what a contrast. I am the King of the Jews to I am the Good Shepherd. I am the King of the Jews to I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the King of the Jews to I am the bread of life, and so on. Jesus answered Pilate indirectly when he said, "My kingdom is not from this world." His kingdom? Who has a kingdom but a king? So Jesus was a king. Do we have a king? Do we want a king? Do we need a king? Who is our king? Who or what reigns in our lives? Who or what rules in our hearts? From infancy, we assert our independence. I'll do it myself. Thank you very much. I'll do it my way. Thank you very much. We take charge. We take command. But are we really in charge? Do we have control? Chaos enters our lives. Our lives can get messy. Illnesses and injuries happen. They can be life-threatening, life-changing, and at the very least, disruptive. Markets can be volatile, putting our hard-earned money, our way of life, and our retirement at risk. Relationships can break. Some will heal and be stronger, while others will end. The economy can tank, businesses close, resulting in the loss of jobs. Derechos, tornadoes, floods, wildfires, wars destroy houses and communities. Loved ones die. We fool ourselves into thinking we are in charge. We are in control. But yet we still gird up our loins and we will not submit to anyone or anything. We will not tolerate the idea of something or someone having power over us. But here's the truth. Something does have power over us. As much as we try to deny it, as much as we resist it, sin has power over us. The truth is, we need a king. We need a different kind of king. We need a king who will bring order out of chaos. We need a king who will bring good out of bad. We need a king who will defeat sin once for all. Jesus is the only king who has, who is, who will, and who can do all of this. What does it mean that Jesus' kingdom is not from this world? Is Jesus' kingdom from heaven? Is his kingdom detached, distant from the world we live in? Does Jesus sit passively at the right hand of the Father? Does Jesus reign over us, within us, and among us? Is his kingdom not about fighting over power? Who's right and who's wrong? Not about claiming dominance, using every possible way, including deception, intimidation, and violence. Is his kingdom a kingdom of nonviolence, where peace, justice, equality, and unity reign? And what is our role? What is our place in God's kingdom? Do we play a passive or an active role in it? Jesus calls us to an active role in his kingdom through the waters of holy baptism, calling us to strive for justice and peace throughout the world. calling us to love our neighbors as ourselves, calling us to do unto others as we would have them do unto us, calling us to forgive as we have first been forgiven, calling us to proclaim Christ the crucified and risen King through word and deed, calling us to love, care, and advocate for all people, especially the poor, the marginalized, and the stigmatized. Calling us to love and care for God's good creation, setting an example through faithful stewardship practices. Ours is not passive in this kingdom. Ours is an active. So today we confess Jesus as King. And adapting the words of the song by Tula Paris, we're going to hear Jackie play it through, and I'm going to sing the verse.
Thank you.
his Son our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rooted in God's abundant love for the world, let us pray for our neighbors, the church, and all of creation.
Revive our congregations, synods, and national church body to reflect the love, justice, and kinship of your kingdom. Raise up diverse leaders who teach and serve your people, merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
Nourish parched lands and bring relief to flooded places. Protect wildlife, habitats, and endangered species. That the course of creation's praise resounds with joy. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
Grant wisdom to the leaders who govern, legislate, and deliberate on our behalf. Advance your nonviolent reign of justice-seeking love through their work. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
Draw near to those who are detained or on trial or incarcerated. Transform systems of retribution into systems of reconciliation and restoration. Empower activists who advocate for change. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
Remind us of your enduring love in all seasons. Guide the planning efforts of worship leaders and volunteers who usher our congregation into a meaningful Advent. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
In your eternal presence, the saints, including Cedric and Rebecca, sing of your majesty. Join our voices with theirs in praise to the one who loves us and frees us from sin. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
Grant comfort and healing to all who are sick or recovering from surgery, especially Rich, Larry, and all those we name aloud or silently in our hearts before. Abide with all to whom death draws near. Surround and fill them and their loved ones with your peace. Let your hope reign in their hearts. Merciful God. We offer our prayers to you, gracious God, trusting in your boundless love for all that you have made through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us turn to one another and share a sign of God's peace.
Thank you.
portion and our cup. You offered yourself in love for the world, and in this meal you nourish us with your life. Fill us with your abundance, that we may feed the hungry and welcome the stranger, trusting in your name.
able to receive the blessing. And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you now and always in his grace.
Encouraged one another in Christ, be the salt.
Amen.